We've been doing a study. This is week five of the study, and I'm just calling it Israel, God's timepiece, because it really is. There's an old saying, and just because old sayings are old doesn't mean they're not true. The old saying is that if you want to know what time it is on God's clock, look at Israel. And there's so much that we take for granted, just Israel's a nation, it exists in the land, but that it was gone for so long is a major, major issue. And so they're back in the land, and we're doing this as what I like to call sort of the backstory behind our study in Revelation on Sunday mornings, because there's really a great deal of detail in the book of Revelation that we don't have time for on Sundays. Obviously, as you know, I talk a lot, and so we don't have time for even the stuff I'm saying. So I like to try and use this for those who are interested to understand better the what we call the Old Testament, but it's all the same. It's one Bible. So, but the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible background behind the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is 404 verses, but it contains more than 800 references and symbols and types and allusions that are only found in the Tanakh, or the Old Testament, 39 books of the Old Testament. And so I'm trying to go through some of these things, and also at the same time, and I hope you don't take this the wrong way, but to sort of refresh us, refresh our memories, or learn for the first time some basic rules of what we'll call, it's a fancy word, you don't get to use it much, so I get to use it, hermeneutics, which just means how do you see something? How do you interpret really anything? How do you interpret the Bible? There's an old saying, and just because it's old, it doesn't mean it's not true. In fact, it's very true. There's really only one interpretation of the Bible. People say all the time, well, you know, there are so many different ways of interpreting the Bible. And I guess that's a half-truth, because you could say there are many ways, but there's only one right way of interpreting the Bible. Someone would say, oh, your way is the right way. No, God's way is the right way, and it's a matter of reading through the Scripture, and you know, it's become almost a mantra in the way I've been saying it, but to read through the Scripture systematically, to read through the Scripture in a way that we believe it, and I'll say literally, even when it's a metaphor or a similar, or some figure of speech, it's obvious that God is using it as a figure of speech, so we take it literally as a figure of speech. Read through it grammatically. Read through the Scripture with anticipation of what God is going to reveal to us, and that's important that we do that. One of the things that I was reminded of this week that I haven't been saying, and I really should, this is an important rule. One of the rules of interpreting the Scripture is, and it's really one of the, it's like Bible interpretation 101, the law of first mention. And that is, you know, when a word or a concept is first introduced in the Scripture, it will be carried through the rest of the Scripture, but the context in which it's first introduced tends to color its meaning, or the way that we would interpret it or use it later on. But akin to that, or maybe the second law, if you want to call it a law, is the idea of, and this comes back to the idea of many interpretations, when the plain sense makes the most sense, seek no other sense. You know, when it just makes sense to read it this way, don't go looking for something mysterious. Take it as it says it. Take it as what God has said, because he's written it for all of us. He didn't write it for seminary grads. He didn't write it for people with doctorates in ministry and that kind of stuff. He wrote it for me and you, and you know, just regular stuff people. So, and in many ways, the sort of the key verse that I've been going off of throughout this study is, and it's on your notes, but Isaiah 46, 9 through 10. I should make it a memory verse for us, but You don't worry, you don't have to read it up. But remember the former things of old, God says, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning. He's outside of time. He can do that. And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. So, and we've looked at some of these basic principles so far. We've looked at, again, the law of first mention. We've looked at this idea that a concept is introduced and then it's developed. As you start in Genesis and move through the scripture, it develops with progress. The Bible is the progressive revelation. Now, it wasn't written as one big data dump. It didn't just boom, fall on earth. You know, things happened, and then it started to be written down as God revealed himself to the patriarchs, and then Moses would write the Torah, and it goes on from there, of course. And we have 66 books in the English Bible, 66 books written down by 40 different writers, one author, the Holy Spirit, over a couple thousand years, and it all fits together. But it's the Bible is the revelation of God's plan to redeem mankind. That's what the Bible is. You can call it a lot of other things. That's what it is. But the only thing I would add to that, it's a progressive revelation. And so when a concept is introduced, we see that it's clarified as we move forward. So that when we get to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, these things tend to, you know, it makes more sense. If we try to read the book of Revelation without understanding the Old Testament, we really get lost very quickly because there's so many symbols that are rooted in the Old Testament. I know I've said that a lot over time, but and we've looked at a number of things, and I just want to skip through some of this, but one of the things that we looked at 2 weeks ago, the important idea of the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. This is a concept that flows throughout the entire scripture and culminates in the book of Revelation. The seed of the woman will crush the head of the seed of the serpent. And that's important for us to understand. And this one that people call Antichrist, the great world leader who has these 33 titles from the Old Testament and 13 titles in the New Testament, we call him Antichrist. He's the seed of the serpent, and I believe we're in the very last days now, and that he's on earth right now. But just to clarify that, I think that it's my opinion, and I'm entitled to it. You're entitled to yours too. But if we take the Bible literally, if we understand that the Lord has said that, you know, he'll return for the church at any time as a thief in the night, as far as the world is concerned, then the clock will start ticking. And at that point, the devil has to be ready with a man who's going to come in and take that role as the great world ruler. So that means that since the time of Jesus Christ, there's been one on earth. The devil's always had to have someone ready because he doesn't know when God's going to do it. He just knows that God is going to do it. So this man is alive today. We spent some time last week looking at the 70-week prophecy of Daniel, 70-week prophecy that we find in Daniel chapter 9. And we're going to spend a little time there again. Some of this that I'm going to start with will be a little bit of review, and then we'll get into some other things. But and this idea of the 70-week prophecy is a very provocative one. It explains a lot in Scripture. But just to back off of that for a moment, one of the things that we looked at last week is that when you look at the history of Israel, this is why I say Israel is God's timepiece. When we see Israel as God's timepiece, we see that God looks at things a certain way, not the way that man looks at things. And it's not a matter of getting him to jump on our wagon and to see things our way, but for us to see things his way. So it turns out that when you look through biblical history, Israel's history has been divided into four periods of 490 years each. Now, they don't look like 490 years each until you do a little math. And so very quickly, let's just look at it again, about the top of the middle of the first page. Number one, from the call of Abram to the Exodus is a total of 505 years. But if you remove 15 years of that disobedience with Ishmael, that whole business, if you take that 15 years out before Isaac is born, now you're down to 490 years, okay? From the Exodus to the building of the temple, people calculate this a couple different ways, but it still comes out to 490, 601 years. But if you take out the periods of servitude to the various nations during the time of the judges, which is it totals out to 111 years, it's 601 minus 111, you're down to 490 years. From the completion of the temple to the edict of Artaxerxes Longimanus, which we'll look at that in a moment, we looked at it last week, it's 560 years. But when you take out the 70 years of the servitude of the nation in Babylon, you're down to 490 years. And then when we got to Daniel chapter 9 last week, and we see this prophecy that Gabriel gives to Daniel of 490 years. He says there will be 70 weeks, or you don't care about the Hebrew, but anyhow, he's 70 shabuim, 70 weeks or sets of, it turns out to be 7 years each, or 490 years. And he says there in Daniel chapter 9, and you may as well turn there because we're going to look there, in Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, he says 70 weeks have been 70 weeks have been determined for your people and your holy city. We get very confused. Again, you know, and I know what it was like for me when I got saved, and I wasn't reading the Old Testament. I read some things in the Old Testament. I read some Genesis stuff. That was cool because the whole creation thing. And, you know, once you got me into genealogies, I was out of there. I didn't want to follow genealogies. And so I just got lost in a lot of stuff in the Old Testament when I was, you know, a younger believer. And I didn't understand all this king stuff. And I wasn't reading systematically. I wasn't doing it. So I just kind of stayed in the New Testament. You know, and that's even when I was trying to be an obedient Christian, let alone when I was way off the ranch. So I didn't really understand these things. And then trying to understand matters that have to do with, you know, end time prophecy, the return of the Lord, I didn't understand, well, why are we talking about a 7 year period where, you know, all these things are going to happen in the last days, this tribulation period? Or even when we look at, you know, this 70 week prophecy, And the 7 years of it, you know, to me, it just seemed like, well, it deals with the whole world. So it's all about the whole world. But God always says what he means, and he always means exactly what he says. So when he says that 70 weeks of 7 years, or 490 years, have been determined for your people, Daniel, and for your holy city, he means for Israel and for Jerusalem. And that becomes a theme that continues to echo throughout the prophecies for Israel and for Jerusalem, for the people of Israel and for the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is, and you know, people consider this, and if you've been on a tour with us, you've heard it. If you're going on the tour with us, you'll hear it. You know, that when you really get right down to it, Israel is the center of the earth. Not the geocentric center, but I mean it's where everything comes together, and Jerusalem is the center of Israel, and the Temple Mount is the center of Jerusalem, and the temple is the center of this Temple Mount, and the Holy of the Holies is the center of everything. That's the key. That's where it all happens. That's where atonement was made for sin before Christ came, right? And so interestingly enough, and this is, I shouldn't go off on tangents like this, but you know, people ask these questions all the time. We all have these questions when we come to Ezekiel chapter 40 and 40 to 48, and we're talking about the kingdom period, you know, after Christ has returned and set up this glorious kingdom, and the temple is standing in the millennial kingdom, and yet they're still offering sacrifices. And you say, well, whoa, wait a minute. I thought you know, okay, I get it, before the cross that they were offering sacrifices, but Jesus is the sacrifice once for all, so why sacrifices afterward? Well, so the sacrifices before the cross were looking forward to the cross. The sacrifices after the cross were an echo, a remembrance of, a memorial of the cross. So everything is focused on the cross. So all that to say, Jerusalem is the center of everything, and that's why it's critical that we always be looking at Israel and Jerusalem. And just to come way back out, pan or zoom way out again, and to understand that there was no Israel. The earth after the flood, as it began to repopulate, was filled with a bunch of people. It was filling with a bunch of people. And God calls a man named Abram, and he calls him at the age of 75 years old from a place that we would today call Kuwait, or Ur of the Chaldees, it's called in Scripture, near or just below, just south of Iraq. And he calls Abram and his wife Sarai, who's barren, and calls him and says, leave your people, leave everything behind, and just follow me, and I will make you into a great nation. And many other things that he says. I will make you into a great nation. It's a promise. It's not a covenant. It's a promise that he makes to Abraham. And he says, and through you, all the people, kings will come from you, nations will come from you, and through you, all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. I mean, you can't get more over the top than that kind of a promise. Are you with me? Okay. So now think about this. When we think of the world, if we think this way, when we think of the world, we think Jews and Gentiles. Well, Gentiles is just an English word it's an English word. But in Hebrew, goyim. That's what most of us are. There may be some people in here with Jewish blood, but the rest of us, we're goyim. Goy in Hebrew just means a nation. Goyim means nations. It's just a plural, nations. So you had goyim. That's all that there were in the world before God spoke to Abram and said, leave earth and come and follow me, and I promise I will do these things. And what he's saying is, I will make you into a nation. And from your very loins, I will bring a promised seed. Seed is a key word. It starts all the way back in Genesis 3:15. I will bring the promised seed, who is Isaac, the promised son. And through you and through him and through his sons, et cetera, I will bring this great blessing. It's a promise. I will make a nation from you. And so out of all the goyim of the world, the nations of the world, God picks one man. And not because he was righteous. See, we think sometimes, oh, it's because he was righteous, he was such a good guy. It's pretty obvious. You read Joshua, the end of Joshua. He says, you know, they were worshiping idols on the other side of the river. That's what Euphrates over there. So he was an idol worshiper. Just like, you know, we were, you know, way off the reservation before God called us to himself. God calls Abram to himself. And he makes this promise to him. And from him, he becomes the archetype of Israel. He's not Israel. He becomes the archetype of Israel. It's not till his grandson, Jacob, later on, his name is changed to Israel, and then from him come these 12 tribes, et cetera, et cetera. So I know I'm getting off a bit, but I just want us to keep in focus what's going on, because it's very easy to lose focus in some of this. So God says to Daniel, now we're in the middle of the history of Israel. Israel has been in the land, and under Solomon, there was a great amount of idolatry that happened during Solomon's reign. And ultimately, because of God's faithfulness to David and to the remembrance of David, he says to Solomon, what you've done is wrong, but I will not harm the nation now, but after you die, I will. And after Solomon's death, the nation is divided, 10 tribes to the north, 2 tribes to the south. 10 tribes to the north are called, they retain the name Israel, and the 2 tribes to the south are called Judah. It's actually 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin, but they get the name Judah. And it really just refers to the land area, Judah. Okay, but those are the tribes that were living there. And the righteous people from the north, they chose not to follow Jeroboam and worshiping the golden calf and all that stuff up north. They came to the south. And so you had representatives from all of the tribes who were living in the land of Judah, but the people in the north continued to worship these idols. And you know, you read through the book of the Kings and you find out that it was a real sorry mess in the northern kingdom. Until finally, in 721, Sennacherib, king of the Assyrians, comes and hauls off basically one out of five Israelites, or those from the north, and distributes them into other lands, and then brings people from other lands and has them intermarry with the Israelites who were living in that northern kingdom. And it's not until 605 or 606, depending upon how you want to count it, BC, that something happens in the southern kingdom too. Judah is also worshiping idols. And God finally says, he doesn't say it this way, but in effect what he says is, you want idols? If you want idols that much, I will send you to the land of idols. And he has this one Nebuchadnezzar. He raises up Nebuchadnezzar, who is the king now. He inherits it from his father, who he finds out has just died. And he's in the area. He's over in the western area. He finishes, you know, fighting the battle of Carchemish. And he comes in to take Israel as his trophy. And not realizing that God has raised him up as his instrument of punishment against Judah. And he hauls off the best and the brightest, we talked about this last week, including Daniel and his friends and all that, the best and the brightest, hauls them off to Babylon. Does some damage, but basically it's against the land that he does. And for 70 years, the people are kept in Babylon. And it's referred to later on as the servitude of the nation. Now, I'm not, in a way, I'm getting ahead of myself, but I just want us to understand that. And there are two other sieges of Nebuchadnezzar. Now, it's during that first period, that first 70 years from 606 BC onward. Daniel is taken as a young man. Some people say as maybe as young as 12. Some people say he was 13, 14. But, you know, this is a very young man. Puberty, basically. And he's taken off. And so now he's a much older man by the time we get to Daniel chapter 9. And he's praying. And he's praying on behalf of the nation. And no sin is ever attributed to Daniel. No doubt he was a sinner, because all have sinned, right? But no sin is ever attributed to him. But he claims all of the things that God held against the nation of Judah, he claimed for himself. He claimed himself as part of it. And he said, God, I know, based upon reading Jeremiah and the prophecies of Jeremiah, that the time of the servitude of the nations is coming to an end. When is it going to be? And he understood that it was going to be 70 years, and so he's probably 80 years old or so at that point, and he prays this. Daniel has this appearance of Gabriel in his, I would say his bedroom, I don't know where it was. I'd always be freaked out. I remember being a young Christian saying, you know, if I could just see an angel, you know, in my bedroom. And then I started reading the Bible more, as I started walking with the Lord more, and said, boy, seeing angels, they can really freak you out. But Gabriel appears to him, and he says that, and we went through this last week, that 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city, for Israel and for Jerusalem. And again, very quickly, verse 24, the scope of the prophecy. To finish transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And you know, I always like to ask, has that occurred yet? No, not like you notice. All you have to do is turn on the TV and you can tell that hasn't happened yet. In some aspects, people will argue, well, come on, Jesus Christ came and there was atonement for sin. Yeah, but all of these things that are mentioned here have not occurred yet. So this 490-year prophecy, this 70 sets of 7 years each, or 490 years, obviously has not been completed. And it's a technical prophecy, and we dealt with the technical stuff last week, so I just want to, you know, kind of skim over it to bring us back up to speed. And he says, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem." So this is before that command. Gabriel's saying there's going to be a command that's going to be given, or an edict that's going to be given, it's got to be royal to allow it to happen, because Israel is captive. They're in Babylon. So from the going forth of the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, I call that point A on the line, until is always an important word. It could, and really, look it up someday. Take a concordance and just look up until in the Bible, and all the untils, all the periods of time that God deals with. He deals with lots of periods of time, and it's easier to understand how he works if you look at those things. He says, from the going forth of the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, or Messiah the King, your Bible may say, shall be, and this is a technical point, we're just going to sum it up, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. So it's a total of what? 7 plus 62 equals? Math majors? 69. That equals 69. Right? 7 plus 62 equals 69. Okay, so I make sure my head's working here. Okay, I've been teaching this wrong all these years. And then he says how the street's going to be built again and the wall, even in troublesome times. So, what is it? Point A is a giving of a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, because Jerusalem is in rubble. By this point, there have been 3 sieges against Israel and Jerusalem: 606 BC, 595 BC, and 586 or 87, depending upon how you want to count it, BC. 3 of them. The first one, 606 BC, Neb comes. We're on good terms. I've been reading about him for a long time. So Neb comes and he brings some destruction in the land, but basically he hauls off, as I said earlier, the best and the brightest, and he installs a vassal king whose name is Jehoiakim. And this vassal king is to do whatever Neb says. That's how they rolled in those days. That's how empires worked. And, you know, the conqueror set up a vassal to do whatever the conqueror wanted. And the false prophets said, throw them off. We're God's people. This is supposed to happen. God has promised us victory. And Jehoiakim begins to believe that. He ends up dying. His son Jehoiakim, Jehoiakim and Jehoiakim, it sounds confusing. One's ends with an M, the other ends with an N. Jehoiakim takes his place and doesn't last for long. And he too follows the false prophets. Nebuchadnezzar hears about it, is ticked. He comes back and he brings the second siege against Jerusalem, hauls off a lot of the holy vessels and things from the temple, and establishes another, or sets up another vassal king, Zedekiah. And Zedekiah then rules from 595 until 586, 87. So not very long, right? 8 years at most. 8, 9 years. And during that time, same thing happens with Jehoiakim and Jehoiakim. The false prophets are saying, don't do this, you know, we're God's people. And Ezekiel is saying one thing, and Jeremiah, they're contemporaries, and they're both saying things to Zedekiah. One saying that, you know, you're never going to see. One says that you're going to die in Babylon, and the other says you're never going to see Babylon. Zedekiah is saying you guys can't even get your story straight, you know. But it turns out when you read the rest of the story, they take Zedekiah out in 586 when Zedekiah is overthrown and Nebuchadnezzar just destroys. He levels the city. He destroys the temple, and Zedekiah tries to escape through one of the routes that you'll see on the tour. He tries to escape. The Babylonians capture him and his sons. They slaughter his sons before his eyes, and then they poke his eyes out. Haul him off to Babylon. So he dies in Babylon, but he never saw it because he was blind. God says what he means, and he means what he says. Words mean things. Rush Limbaugh didn't invent that phrase, okay? God did. His words mean things. And so, this is way off topic, but I just want to kind of give you the color behind it, because I think it's exciting when you finally see it. This is humanity. This is people who are making these decisions. God's saying, I've got a way I want you to to work here. I want you to worship me, not these idols. And so this is the result of that. Okay, so Daniel is asking this question, and Gabriel gives him the answer from the giving of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the coming of Messiah the Prince shall be what turns out to be a total of 69 weeks of 7 years of peace. We looked at last week the idea that sevens or Sabbaths are very prevalent throughout the scripture. When we think of Sabbath, we think of, oh, that's just the Jewish word for Saturday, okay? But because there's Sabbaths of days, but there are also Sabbaths of weeks. The Feast of Pentecost is known as the Feast of Weeks. It's 7 weeks after the Passover. There are the Sabbaths of months from Tishri to Nisan is 7 months. It's a very important period of time. And there are Sabbaths of years. That's what we look at here. In fact, God even says in Jeremiah 25, he says, you're going to go into Babylon as my prisoners there, because for 490 years you have not kept the Sabbath for the land. 6 days, 6 weeks you plow the you're to till the soil, and the seventh you're to let it lay fallow. But they didn't do that. He said, for 490 years you haven't obeyed the Sabbath for the land, so you owe me 70. God does collect. And so that's why the 70 number is so important. That's why they spend the 70 years after the first siege, the siege against Israel, okay, or the servitude of the nation. All right, so we looked at last week. There's a lot of different decrees as you read through the scripture, but the decree that matters is the one we read about in Nehemiah chapter 2, and we looked at it last week. So I'm just, again, this is just summary to kind of set us up for where we go from here. In Nehemiah chapter 2, King Artaxerxes Longimanus, there's a couple of Artaxerxes, okay? But Artaxerxes Longimanus is the one who gives Nehemiah the decree. He gives him the decree, he gives him the materials, he gives him the money, he gives him the armed guards, he gives him everything he wants and everything he needs to go to Jerusalem to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. There are four decrees altogether, the last one being the fourth one, Artaxerxes Longimanus. That's a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, the walls and the streets. But the first three decrees are decrees to go and restore the temple. Turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 45. I want to tell you a quick story. We've got time. A very quick story. Some of you are very familiar with it, I hope. Isaiah 45, but let me just summarize something that happens in Daniel chapter 5. In Daniel chapter 5, you remember the first four chapters of Daniel are Daniel's relationship with Nebuchadnezzar. It's how he's brought to Babylon in the first place. Chapter 1, chapter 2, Neb has the dream, and he tells the wise men who he's inherited from his father, I've had a dream, tell me what I dreamed, and then give me the interpretation. He wants to see if the old codgers can cut the mustard. And they say, just tell us what you saw, and we'll tell you what it means. He goes, yeah, you don't get off. Tell me what I dreamed, and tell me what it means, or I'll cut off your heads and make your houses a dunghill. Incentive plan. And so he does this, and they can't do it. Daniel says, not so fast. I can't interpret it, but I know a God who can. And so they he and his guys pray, they come back, and chapter 2 is all about him telling Nebuchadnezzar what he saw and what it means. And then we read chapter 3, that's the story about, you know, his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and the fiery furnace and all that. Chapter 4 is actually a chapter, it's the only chapter in the Bible written by a Gentile king. It's written by Nebuchadnezzar about how he went crazy and what happened. And Talmud says that Daniel took care of him during that time. Chapter 5 is about how, after Neb dies, his son Belshazzar is a wicked king, has no respect for Daniel, and is having this party, the great party, where, you know, the handwriting on the wall party, where this, you know, suddenly there's a hand writing on the wall. That would freak you out. It doesn't matter if you're sober, they were drunk, but it wouldn't matter if you were sober or drunk. You know, when a big hand comes, I don't know if it's like, you know, one of those big things you see at the Eagles games, but you know, a big hand that starts writing many, many tekel upharsin, you know, you've been weighed in the balance and found wanting. Not cool. And it was Daniel who was brought out of retirement. He's a very old man at that point, and he's the one who gives the interpretation. What's happening at that time, and this is what's important to understand, why I've told you to go to Isaiah 45. What's happening at that time is Cyrus, he's king of the Medo-Persian Empire. When we think of the Medes, I'll leave it there. The Medo-Persian Empire. So they're a united group at that point. He's the king and general over them. And what he does is, I mean, incredible engineering. If you think about this, so this is without, you know, the Army Corps of Engineers. This is the Medo-Persian Corps of Engineers. And they divert the Euphrates River far upstream. They divert the Euphrates River because the Euphrates went right through the middle of Babylon, and the Babylonians had just, they built this incredible structure in the city. They built these iron gates that went down into the river, right? So that no one could just get in with a boat. You couldn't invade the city with a boat, and they had this big wall around it. No one could invade the city of Babylon. Cyrus figured out how. He diverted the Euphrates River so that the water level went down, and his men went in under the gate, and then they came into the room where Belshazzar was having the party. And it was a drunken orgy, and it was a total bloodbath. They slaughtered all of the officials who were there. And yet, it only happened there. It was actually days before most people even knew that it had happened in Babylon. It was only the officials who were taken out. And the interesting thing, and I want, now, this is Talmudic legend, so you take it for what you want, but I mean, there, you know, it's not written in the Bible. What we're going to read is written in the Bible, but what I'm going to say to you is written in the Talmud with the sense of great authority. And what we're told, what did I say, 45, I'm just going to read a few things beginning in verse 44. 44, verse 6, thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. And who can proclaim as I do? Then let him declare it and set it in order for me. He says, verse 24 of chapter 44, thus says the Lord your Redeemer and he who formed you from the womb, I am the Lord who makes all things, who stretches out the heavens, who spreads abroad the earth by myself, who frustrates the signs of the babblers and drives the diviners mad. I'll bet he does. He really does freak them out. Who turns wise men backward and makes their knowledge foolishness. This is a God you don't want to mess with. Who confirms the word of his covenant and performs the counsel of his messengers, who says to Jerusalem, now watch this. Isaiah is writing this in the 8th century, like the 700s, okay? And the things that happened, like when Babylon was invaded, not destroyed, invaded by the Medes and the Persians. Now we're talking 537 BC. Okay, this is a long time. So we could be 150 to 200 years from the time Isaiah has written this to the event that I just described. You with me? Okay. I made the mistake last week of saying two times, I know it's warm in here, you know, but, you know, and you're really excited, like being cynical, and then I watched Eric walk out and thinking, oh, that was a hint. I got to turn the air conditioning cooler. But I just want to make sure that you're getting what's going on here, because he says halfway through 26, who says to Jerusalem, you shall be inhabited? Who says to the cities of Judah, you shall be built, and I will raise up her waste places? Who says to the deep, be dry, and I will dry up your rivers? Who says of Cyrus? Who's Cyrus? Where'd Cyrus come from? There's no basis for saying Cyrus anywhere in the previous 43 chapters of Isaiah. Suddenly, God mentions Cyrus. Who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure, saying to Jerusalem, in other words, he says to Cyrus, that you, Cyrus, will say to Jerusalem, you shall be built, and to the temple your foundations shall be laid. Thus says the Lord to his anointed. You with me? I'm chapter 45, verse 1 now. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus. He actually calls him anointed. Think of this. A Gentile pagan king, God says, you're my anointed one. That's a big deal. Christ is an English word for anointed. Okay? Who says to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that you may know that I, the Lord, Jehovah, that who call you by name, that I am the God of Israel. Talmudic legend says that it was at this time, because Daniel was alive, according to Daniel chapter 5. He was brought out of retirement to interpret what was written on the wall by that hand, by the hand of God. And Talmudic legend is that he went out into the street and he met Cyrus. And he said, I need to show you something. This is your name, isn't it? This is the God of Israel. He wrote this before you were ever born, 150 years before you were born. And he says, this is what you're to do. Here in Babylon are all these Israelites. And you're to set us free, and you're to send us back so that we'll, rebuild the temple and rebuild the city and all that. Would you be impressed if you were Cyrus? He was really impressed. And as you read the end of 2 Chronicles and 2 Kings and you read Ezra, that's exactly what he did. He sent them back. He said, anybody who wants to go, go. He gave them financial incentives to go. And he actually taxed the people of Babylon, now part of Persia. He taxed them to give financial incentives to the Jews to go back. And how many go back? We find out in the book of Ezra, like 42,000 go back. At least a half a million people, maybe a million or more, were left, which really gives a lot of information about why Esther becomes a very important book in the Bible. Okay, don't hang around. When God says it's time to leave, don't hang around. You might get your head cut off, all right? So anyhow, I know I digress, but I think that's one of those important things to understand. From the giving of the decree to go and restore Jerusalem until the coming of Mashiach, or the Messiah, the Prince, shall be what turns out to be 483 years. And we did the math last week. That's if you look at that in days, because years in the Hebrew Bible are always, it doesn't matter when they're referred to, whether you're talking about the Old Testament or the New Testament, or what time in the Old Testament, a year is 360 days. Some people say, how can a year be 360 days? All ancient calendars were 360 days up until 701 BC. At least 20 calendars have been found that were 360 days. And in 701 BC, something happened that changed the rate at which the time it took for the earth to go around the sun. And so all the calendars changed, and the Hebrew calendar changed. Hezekiah, the calendar changed for him, and he had to come up with a kind of a leap year system. They added an extra month every few years for like a 13-year cycle. Anyhow, so But he's dealing with 360-day years. God's consistent. He uses that. So if we take the 483 years and we multiply it by 360 days in a year, all the math is here, just don't worry, it comes out to 173,880 days. And now we have to convert it to our calendar, which is a 365-and-a-quarter day calendar, roughly, because we have a leap year, right, every 4 years. And when we convert it, and you do a few other special conversions that need to take place, Robert Anderson is the one who wrote The Coming Prince. I think we have it in the bookstore. If not, you know, you can get it. But Sir Robert Anderson, he was knighted for the work. He was the one who did the research to determine when it was that Nehemiah would have left Persia in order to head over to Jerusalem. And turns out it was March 14, 445 BC. That was the giving of the decree to go and restore Jerusalem. And if you lay out the days, so to speak, like a string, you come out to April 6, 32 AD. And that's the day that Jesus makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. See, because there were many times, and you read through the Gospels, probably all of us, most if not all of us in this room, have read the Gospels, all the Gospels. And you can look at the many times that people tried to make Jesus king, but he always was reticent. You know, he always pulled back. He would even say it a number of times, and John records him, saying, "My time has not yet come." But on that day, April 6, 32 AD, on the 10th of the month of Nisan, 4 days before Passover, that was the day the lambs were being examined in the temple to see if they were suitable to be offered on the Passover. That's when he not only allows people to worship him as king, he sets it up. And, you know, he gets on the donkey, he rides into Jerusalem, and because he's officially rejected that day, that's when the Pharisees officially reject him, and he rebukes them, and he says, "If you had only known on this your day what would bring you peace, but now it's hidden from your eyes, the day of God's coming to you." And he says, and then he warns them, he tells them what's going to happen. Your enemies are going to build an embankment against you, hem you in on every side, slaughter your children within your walls. And that happens 38 years later, which is another important number we won't get into tonight, but 38 years later, on an interesting day, the 9th of the month of Av, the Jewish month of Av, in 70 AD, and that's when Jerusalem was destroyed the second time. All right, we're going through that because what happened? The clock stopped. Remember, we were talking about the other 490-year periods that are longer periods, but when you take out the periods of disobedience, the clock stops when the disobedience occurs. When the disobedience ends, clock starts going again. The clock stopped at that point, April 6, 32 AD, and the clock has stopped ever since. Because there's 1 week of years left. It's called the 70th week of Daniel. And he says here, somewhere, wherever I was, in Daniel chapter 9, he describes what's going to happen. He says that after these 69 years, or 69 weeks of years, the Messiah will be, verse 26, will be cut off, or executed, will be cut off, but not for himself. No, he was executed for me and for you. Why not for himself? Because he was innocent. He didn't deserve to be executed. He came to do it for us. He'll be cut off. Karat means to be executed for a capital crime in Hebrew, but not for himself. And this is where it gets a little complicated, but it's important to understand what we're looking at when we come to the tribulation period that we're studying on Sunday mornings. And the people of the prince who shall come. There's a prince who's going to come later. But the people of that prince are going to do something. He says they will destroy the city and the sanctuary, right? That's 70 AD. Destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. You could call it a diaspora. And until the end of the war, desolations have been determined. Then he... Verse 27, he, who is he? He's the prince who shall come. The people, the Romans, right, destroyed the city and the sanctuary. Not one stone was left on another, just exactly as Jesus said. Titus wanted to save the temple as a trophy of war. But one of the soldiers shot a flaming arrow into one of the upper, they had draft windows, and shot a flaming arrow in there. The inside of the temple, I mean, it was all limestone, but the inside of the temple was cedar lined with gold, and it began to burn. And the heat of it, limestone has a lot of water content, the heat of it caused the limestone now to explode, and the whole thing was destroyed. Titus, as you can imagine, was not real pleased. And so he did the second best thing he could do. He had his soldiers remove one stone from another and scrape the gold off so he could at least get the gold from it. And you can see it. We've seen it. If you've been on the tour, you've seen the scrape marks on the stone. And that's what they did, fulfilling exactly what Jesus had prophesied would happen. Who's he? The prince who shall come. We call him Antichrist, call him the great world leader, call him, you know, Mr. Big Mouth because he's very boastful. He's called all kinds of things. He's called the seed of the serpent. He's called many things. He shall confirm or make strong a covenant with the many, with Israel. There's going to be a covenant that's going to be made, and it will be for 1 week. It's the last week. It's for 7 years. That's why we know that the tribulation period is 7 years long, because it's the last week of the prophecy. In the middle of the week, and this is something that's said, it's said in Revelation and it's said in the book of Daniel many times, this 7 year period is divided into 42 months and 42 months, 1260 days, 1260 days, a time times and half a time, meaning a year, 2 years, and a half a year, and then that's the middle, and then another year, years, and a half a year. The Holy Spirit couldn't be more precise unless he'd written it down in nanoseconds for us, right? It's very obvious. It's amazing how people want to allegorize these things. If the plain sense makes the best sense, seek no other sense. This is what it means. This is what's going to happen. And we're living in the days where this is about to happen. In the middle of the week, meaning at the 3.5 year mark, the prince who shall come, will bring an end to the sacrifice and offering. Now, anybody who's an animal rights person, and I like animals, I love animals. I really am. I mean, I joke about cats, and they are in a different category, but still, I like cats too. You know, they're fine in their place, and, you know, but I can't say anything about it. But cats are fine. If you got a cat, keep a cat. Take mine. Anyhow, I love animals too. But can you imagine worldwide, just think of America, when this temple is built. The point is, this temple is going to be built. And when this temple is built, I'm telling you, this temple is going to be built. Those of you who've been to the Temple Institute with us in Israel, you've seen it. These people are very serious. Most of the vessels have already been designed. In fact, here, advertising. Next week, we're going to build the temple right here. Oh, yeah. Some of you who were with us on the last tour, I was a little, I had kind of gotten tired of some of the people who were guiding us around because they would say things sometimes which were like really weird. And of course, I'm the pastor, so all the people who were with me are like looking at me going, and I'm saying, just be nice, just, you know, and, you know, don't try to trip people up with your Bible questions. And, so I had sent an email a couple times, and finally this guy called me back. I was in Jerusalem, and I was ready to bring some people, you know, that day. And he called me up, and he said, talk to me about this. I explained it, and he said, look, bring your people over, and I'll lead you around. He was like the director of the one, or the, one of the directors of the Temple Institute. I said, well, that's cool. You know, let's do that. And so we developed a little bit of a relationship. He did a good job. And in fact, we just met yesterday, and he goes around with a model of the temple that he lets people help, you know, kind of assemble so that people can see what the temple would look like. It's 1/50th scale. And so it's pretty big. So we have to figure out how we're fitting it in here. But we're going to do that next week. So come build the temple. And but what happens in the temple? What goes on in the temple? What's the first thing you see with, when you walk in into the main court, into the main court of the priest? What do you see? An altar, you know, burning animals. And the smoke going up to heaven. I mean, and this is happening at least, there's two, there's a morning and an evening sacrifice twice a day, but there's all these other sacrifices are going on all the time. Can you imagine PETA and all the animal rights people, what they're going to say about Israel? But it's going to be enforced. It's going to be a covenant that's enforced. But in the middle of that, of the 70th week of Daniel, he's going to bring it, the great world leader will bring it to an end. And he himself will go into the Holy of the Holies. And he will declare himself to be God. That's what Daniel tells us. Not just Daniel. Daniel's not the only one who tells us this. Jesus says it to us. Matthew 24, he also says it in Mark 13, Luke 21, but Matthew 24. He says, when you see the abomination of desolation, that's what Daniel calls it here. He calls this an abomination that creates desolation. When you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, people argue over whether Daniel said it. Jesus saves you all kind of library time. Just Jesus said it. If you don't believe that Jesus, you have much bigger problems than who wrote the book of Daniel, okay? He says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, let the reader understand. He says, then you who are in Jerusalem, head for the hills, paraphrase, head for the hills. They're probably going to Petra. And pray that your flight's not on a Shabbat and not in the winter. Who's he talking to? This is a Jewish prophecy. He's not talking to the church. He's talking to Jewish people. It's a very Israeli type of a prophecy. This is going to happen. So, and we're actually told, and you know, we don't think much about it. It doesn't mean much to us, actually, most of the time, because temple, shtemple. I mean, it's like, you know, so there's no temple. Okay, there's no temple. There hasn't been a temple since 70 AD, but they are going to build it. They've got the plans. They've got almost all of the vessels done. The menorah is on display in Jerusalem. Outside, you can go see it for yourself. Come on, join us. And keep it tight, John. These people are so serious. They've even gotten to the point of, if you're familiar with tilt-up technology, you know, in construction, because a lot of people say, how are you going to get a temple built so quickly? Tilt-up technology. You build the walls off-site, and you bring them on, and then you boom, boom, and, you know, secure them together. They've already got it working. They're working on it off-site. Anyhow, so he's going to cause this to cease. The sacrifice and oblation to cease. He's going to declare himself to be God, and that's when everything really gets poured out. God's wrath really gets poured out. Jesus refers to it. Paul refers to it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It's referred to in chapter 13 of Revelation. The temple standing, the temple existing, is referred to in Revelation chapter 11. There's going to be a third temple. The second temple was destroyed in 70 AD. The third temple is about to be built. I don't know how close about is, but it's going to be built. Now, I want us to understand that, because as we say, okay, well, that's really interesting. There's a strange prophecy, because you can say, so that does sound current. It's like, so the clock stopped in 32 AD, and the clock will start again after the rapture of the church at some point. The clock will start on those last 7 years. That's true. So it makes it sort of a contemporary, obviously it makes it a contemporary prophecy for us, because it's going to happen in our lifetimes. You know, if you're not a believer, it's going to happen while you're here. Trust in Christ. You don't want to be here during that time. But, you know, Ezekiel makes a really weird prophecy. I put it in here. You can look it up. It's in Ezekiel 4, the first 8 verses. But God says to Ezekiel, I want you to go outside, and I want you to lay on your left side for 390 days and facing this direction in Jerusalem. And then I want you to flip over onto your right side and for 40 days I want you to lay on your right side and face this other direction in Jerusalem. And God says that the days represent years. And it's had scholars, you know, baffled for years, like, what does this mean? What does that mean? I mean, there's a lot of weird things like that in the book of Ezekiel, and it's not, like, real easy to figure some of these things out. And so what a lot of scholars have done is to say, well, if we, understanding, you know, that Ezekiel is a contemporary of all of these captivities in Babylon and all that, let's assume this includes, that's the 70-year captivity periods. If we take 70 out of what total of 430 days, 390 plus 40 is 430 days. If we take 70 out of that, we're back to 360 days. What do we do with that? Well, it's really hard to figure out what to do with that. But there is an interesting scripture in Leviticus chapter 26. He says there, if you continue to disobey me, I will multiply your punishment seven times. In fact, God's very emphatic. He doesn't say it once. He doesn't say it twice. He doesn't say it three times. He says it four times in Leviticus 26. I'll multiply your punishment seven times. So what some scholars have done is to say, let's take that 360 day or year period of time and multiply it by seven. What do we get? We get 2,520. And for a lot of people, many people say, well, that's roughly the amount of time from, you know, the captivity in Babylon until Israel became a nation. That's true. But if you get more precise about it and you actually do the math, and put the math on here for you, you get a really interesting number. If you take 2,520 and multiply it as years, and multiply it by 360 days to a year, you get a great number, 907,200. Again, nice warm room, your pulse is really quickening, and that's really exciting. What do you do with that number? Well, if you convert it into our years, it comes out, all the math is here, you can figure it out for yourself later on. To summarize it, it comes out to a not insignificant number. 2,483 years, 9 months, and 21 days. If we go from the first siege of Nebuchadnezzar against Babylon, that's why I went through all that ancient history with you. If you go from the first siege of Nebuchadnezzar, when he hauls the people off to Babylon for 70 years, from the end of the servitude of the nation, this is important, it was the servitude of the nation, it's referred to. You start at that point, and I put the dates on here for you, that's August 6th of 537 BC. From that point, and you lay 907,200 days and stretch it out to point B, you come to a very important date in Israel's history, May 14 of 1948, the day that David Ben-Gurion declared Israel an independent nation. He cites Ezekiel 36 and 37 as his authority, and he says Israel is now a state. We're a self-sufficient state. Next day, five nations declared war against them, but miraculously, they won. The second siege, it doesn't work with. The third siege is when Neb destroyed the city and the temple. And that is referred to as the desolations of Jerusalem, which also they always occur on the ninth of the month of Av. You know, you say, how do Babylonian generals and Roman generals, how do they get their act together? It's not a coincidence. It's amazing if you study the ninth of Av, how many things happen on that day. But anyhow, from that point, from the end of the desolations of Jerusalem, which occurs on August 15, 518 BC, if you put your pointer on point A and stretch 907,200 days out, you come to June 7 of 1967, when Israel regained the Temple Mount. It was destroyed all those years earlier by Nebuchadnezzar, but it was on that day in the Six-Day War that they got the old city and they got the Temple Mount back. God is amazing with what he does with these numbers. Now, I like numbers and stuff, but I'm not looking to make things up because you can't hardly make this stuff up. This is just the way that God works. And I put a little chart in here to give it to you for reference, but it doesn't give you all the specifics. I tried to write it in there for you. I say that to you because these things are happening in our time. And I know that Christians get really excited when we hear about the temple being rebuilt. When we hear about all this stuff that's going on in Jerusalem, and it's exciting, but we have to be careful about why it's exciting. I met with this man, Steve Frankel, who's going to be here next week, the guy from the Temple Institute. And of course, he's very excited. They're going to build the temple. I said, but you understand. I said, I understand you don't read my side of the book, but I read yours. And your side of the book tells me, it's got to tell you, that temple that you're going to build is going to be defiled, that the man of sin is going to come in and he's going to declare himself to be God. It's called the abomination of desolation. You read the book of Daniel. He goes, yeah, I know. I said, well, it's exciting. For me, it's exciting because it tells me that we really are at the end of this age and that Yeshua is coming back. You say he's coming for the first time. I tell you, he's coming for the second time, and he's going to come, and he's going to throw off all of your enemies, and he's going to bring in a 1,000-year kingdom of peace. And I rejoice in that, but let's make sure that we're seeing it the right way. So as Christians, we need to be careful how excited we get. I get excited because it tells me where we're at. I'm not excited about the carnage that's going to come as a result of it. That's something that we need to have mercy and grace and compassion in our hearts to understand and to have a greater love for the Jewish people, because there's a blindness that's come over Israel and a hardness of heart that's God enforced until the day he takes those blinders off their eyes. And I believe that's when we're being raptured. I'm looking forward to that day, and I believe it's soon. Much as I want to see him build that temple next week, I'd rather be raptured long before that. So let's stand together. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for these things, Lord, that you show us. And it's amazing, Lord, these fascinating things that are in your word. And we don't want to just be fascinated by them, Lord, but to grow with greater awe as we look at what you've placed in your word. And someday, Lord, I believe we're going to be able to look back on all these things that were mysteries to us and realize that in a way that we couldn't see because we looked through a glass darkly now, but then face to face, we're going to be able to look in your word and say, oh, it was right there. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you for your love for us. And we lift up, Lord, the nation of Israel. We pray for them, Lord. We pray that many would have the scales fall off their eyes now. For the 144,000, that you would raise them up now, Lord, and prepare them, Lord. And they would remain pure, and they would seek you, and that you would appear to them in dreams, as you have to so many Orthodox already, Lord, that you would appear in dreams, and that they would know that you are the Mashiach Israel. And so, Lord, we love you. We thank you. We thank you for what you've done in our lives, what you're doing in this church. And, Lord, we want to grow in grace with you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.